Topic three. Let's dive into The Office. The American television show, yeah. The Office.
My favorite show of all time.
It is an excellent show. What makes it stand out for you? What are some of the, like, because when you brought this up, I was like, okay, awesome, excellent. I love the show. Is it just the American one? Is it the British one?
It's definitely the American one.
Fuck David Brent.
Yeah. The British one, I guess, is lost on me. It's not... My favorite thing about The Office is how it's definitely outdated, but it also holds up. Like, there's things about it that are outdated, but it's always going to be timeless to me. Like, all these characters, we all know one of them, or some of them, or all of them. They all have experiences you can relate to. The humor is exactly me. Michael Scott, with his ability to make people extremely uncomfortable and say the wrong thing at the wrong time all the time, he is the most beloved character I think that has ever been written. After Goodbye Michael season 7, they lost me. I couldn't carry on. This was like a family I'd been with for 7 years, and when Michael was gone, I didn't give it a chance, and maybe that makes me like a bad fan, but I was such a fan of that family of people, and when they brought in the new characters, like, I was like, oh, I don't want new characters, but it made everything even better. Right now we're just in, I think it's season, we just started season 4. I was watching it before you called. Mm-hmm. And it means so much to me. And then Michael and Jan just got back together and she got her fake boobs, and that was like one of my favorite episodes, because he's trying to figure out how to not get back together with her. And then she just walks in and he's like, we need to get back together. Mm-hmm. And it's a show I cry at. It is a show that just seems so real to me. There's no makeup on these people. They look like your average people in an office. It inspired me to want to work in an office, which, wow, isn't that setting the bar low?
That is. And and like, I don't know why you would look at that and be like, I want to be Dwight.
That's what I want. I'm like, I want to work there. I want to be Creed. Like, I want to have a fake blog that's on a Word document, and think people actually read it. Every time Pam cries, I weep, because it just seems so real. And you can't fake these emotions. Like, they are just some of the most real characters. Where on one hand, I'm like, whoever wrote this is unbelievable. I don't know how you wrote this person. And then on the other hand, I'm like, I know this person. Like, I know this person. I've worked with this person. I'm friends with this person. This is real. These stories are real. It's a show where you can't tell me it's fake. I know it's real. And it has so much heart and so many dumb moments where it is literally a show about how cringeworthy people can be. But then there's Pam's art show, where no one shows up. But then Michael shows up, and he's blown away by her drawing of The Office. And she gets all emotional, because, yeah, he sucks, and yes, he's awful, and he says the stupidest things. But he showed up, and he liked her art, and she hugs him, and then asks if he has something in his pocket, because you couldn't just let it be a beautiful moment. And it just touches me, and there's so many episodes I love, and the Pam and Jim from the beginning to the end, of how they go from we want to be together till we can't to we're with other people to now there's a baby. And it's all so beautiful, and I get very emotional with this show. I think I've watched it. I think this is my ninth run through of it, and this is David's first, and he's enjoying it. It's not his kind of humor, because he gets like uncomfortable with cringe a little bit. I live for cringe humor. Mm-hmm. I am cringe humor, and it's beautiful to me, and it's topical even when it's not, because it's still relatable even if it's old. I love the show.
Yeah, no, it's, I mean, The Office definitely touches on, like, universal office stories. So there is very much, it is a very evergreen show in that, yeah, like, the technology that you're looking at is gonna look old eventually, like, or the computers and stuff that they're looking at, or the fact that they're like they actually have handsets or something like that you might not find in a modern day office, but the stories and the characters are very archetypal kind of tropey characters, but that just makes them relatable and easily identifiable. I work in an office, and I have, I feel like I'm probably the Creed of my office at this point. Like, I was like, oh no, I'm totally the Jim. It's like, no, I'm the weird guy that like people mostly avoid. Either that or I'm the Oscar. I'm probably the Oscar.
I love Oscar. Like, Stanley is like the unsung hero of, he doesn't say much. He doesn't get a lot of screen time. When he does talk, I'm like, oh my God, stop. We just got into the episode where we're at the beach and stuff.
Oh, nice. Yeah, I might even be Stanley, because I'm definitely, like, the one around my office who just kind of rolls my eyes at everything around me. I just keep my head down and do my job. So, yeah, it is very, very relatable, absolutely, of a show. I was, when you brought it up, I was just watching, Chili's revoked their ban of Pam Beasley on Twitter.
Yes!
Jenna Fisher tweeted out, like, in front of a Chili's, like, should I go in? And then Chili's, like, responded and got in on the joke and said, we've officially revoked the ban on Pam Beasley. I was like, yes! So I went back and watched that episode, the Dundies, from that first season. I was like, God, this is a good show. I watched that. I watched the Dunder Olympics from those early seasons. Like,
I love that.
Like, it's awesome. I would watch, they got taken down, but there was a time where I would watch, like, they were called Jam Moments, and it was basically, like, every episode, it would just kind of, like, boil down the episode to, like, the Jim and Pam moments in that episode, in the first handful of seasons, and so they'd be, like, little 3-5 minute videos, and it was just like, yes, this is, like, I don't have the time to watch the whole season, but I can watch like a season's worth of Jim and Pam episodes in like an hour and like get that like heart swelling emotion from those early seasons where it was like
their relationship to me just seemed more genuine and believable than any relationship I've ever seen in any movie or show. Mm-hmm. Like, this was like, these are two real people who just happen to be on a show. Mm-hmm. They love each other. No, they don't, but I, in my heart of hearts, they do.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's like, Joey Noel tweeted out last week or something, basically saying like all of my relationships are like horribly skewed because of like seeing Jim and Pam. It's like, yep, that's like, I definitely find myself wanting a Pam kind of relationship to me as a Jim, and I'm like, oh, that's like, I'm not gonna find that at work. I'm not gonna find that like in my normal day to day. So. It's given me unrealistic expectations. Thanks, Daniel. Sure.
Yeah, jerk.
Jerk.
It's there's so many like just bits in that show. Like, even when Michael says something, it's like cringeworthy or just completely wrong, and Jim just looks over at the camera. Like, you don't do that on TV, but when he does it every time, like, I agree. This is fantastic. I'm just like, I don't know if that's quite right. Don't know if you could say that. But it's such a good show to me with so many memorable moments. It even has great callbacks to other seasons where you're like, oh, this is for me. Like, they put this in here to remind me of, like, 2 seasons ago of, like, I'm still watching this and this is totally for me and I remember this.
Yeah.
All the weird relationships, like Dwight and Angela, it's perfect.
Yeah. That's, like, it's definitely interesting watching, like, the early seasons, rewatching the other seasons, and then like recognizing where they go with characters, or like when they started figuring out characters, like the Office and Parks and Rec was the same in this. Like, they both started out with a weird 6-episode like mini season as basically like a test at the end of a season to like kind of throw in some time, and both of those, like, there are moments, but there are also moments where it's like, oh, they don't know what they're doing yet. Like the Office being the like the most notable, because the first episode of The Office is a beat for beat copy of the first episode of The British Office, just with a couple like minor tweaks.
Yeah.
And it doesn't feel right because it's new character, new actors trying to bring that same flavor. But then they start kind of, when they start finding their own voice in seasons 2 and on, it's like, oh, okay, now like, now they're running on all cylinders. Now they've figured out that, like, Mindy Kaling is a very funny actress and doesn't need to be, like, hidden in the back. So you can bring her kind of the forefront, and you can give her this weird arc with Ryan, where it just becomes the recurring thing of, like, together, not together, kind of the nightmare of that relationship. That's, like, even that, like, Ryan is one of those characters I always, on the show, I was like, I don't get why this is a, like, why he's, I get that he's a writer on the show, and maybe that's why they put him in the show, but, like, there are some good moments in there, and, like, watching the Dundies or whatever, and Michael's infatuation with him in those early years.
It never stops.
It is that, like, cringe, and but at some point I was just like, I feel like, and what it really was for me is I was always like, I feel like he should not be one of the five in the opening credits. It was,
yeah, I love how it's like, oh, you see thing. Michael, Jim and Pam, and BJ Novak. Like, why?
Yeah, that's really what it was. It was like, okay, like, one of these things is not like the others. One of these things doesn't belong, and it's Ryan the Temp. but it was even that was like calling back to the British show's roots, where the Temp, you know, it, like, you could kind of carry out a show about or with a Temp for the two seasons of 12 episodes or whatever, in that just didn't translate necessarily to the American, like, 23 episode season or whatever. But yeah, so, like, absolutely, like, a ton of great bits. I don't know if you, Kyle O'Connor, formerly of IGN, now of Twitch, I follow him on Twitter, he's a community manager and stuff, and he's like watching through The Office for the first time. He's I think season 3 or season 4 or something, and tweeted out the other day of, like, how Kevin is, like, secretly the best character in that
yes.
show. And I had seen, like, a BuzzFeed article that Aaron, I think, had posted on Facebook. Aaron Thatcher had posted, like, a day or two earlier about, like, here are 17 times that Kevin was secretly the best. And it was, like, just some beautiful, great moments of his, like, when he spills his chili on the floor. And, like, ultimate cringe moments
that one.
And stuff. like watching or him getting distracted and counting where he's like 67, 68, 69, 70, 71.
Like the episode where I think it's like the first time Holly visits, maybe, and the whole episode she thinks Kevin is handicapped.
Oh yeah.
She's like, oh wow, that's so great. I didn't know you could drive. He's like, I can drive.
Yeah. Like, yeah, so just, like, every character in there started out as kind of, like, a one-joke thing, and that still throughout kind of, like, becomes their essence, but the subtle flavors that kind of get added to everybody over time, like, I mean, Daryl's one of my favorites, and I'm so glad that, like, Craig Robinson has kind of, like, broken out in the wider scheme of the world since, but, like, he was basically such the anti-Michael that I was like, yes, every time you are on screen, I just want you to, like, bat against Michael and fight that,
like,
cringe.
Like, when Michael's wearing
a
woman's suit, Michael has the woman's suit on, and he's like, is that a woman's suit?
Yeah.
Oh, it was one of my favorite episodes. It's like a Liz Claiborne.
Yeah, I think I've told the story on here before, but when I worked for CVS... we had, like, some crazy shit go down one night, and, like, a drunk woman basically got tackled by the assistant manager and, like, held down until, like, police arrived because she was, like, he says she threw a punch at him. I didn't see it. I just saw him, like, tackle her and take her down to the ground, and then her tube top came down, and so her boobs are just down there on the ground, and it's like, this is really awkward and uncomfortable, and I looked at the security camera and mugged so much that night that the day shift the next day was like, you were Jim, like, just looking at the camera being like, like being, like, he was Michael Scott and I was Jim, and the security camera was the office crew watching.
And she was like Meredith.
Oh, yes. Yep, exactly. it was so weird, but that was, like, one of the highlights of that really shitty job was just the fact that, like, I did it figuring nobody was gonna like watch those security footage things, but the fact that they did, and then they talked to me about it the next day, like, it was hilarious, like, watching you react to everything that was going on. I was like, oh, thanks, I'm glad I was able to put on a show for you guys, because it was really weird being there.
I can't believe how much I love that show, and every time I rewatch it, there's like something else I've missed. And even though, like you said, these characters, like, you know what to expect from them, but they never disappoint. Like, you can usually always guess how different characters are going to react to the situation, but sometimes you're wrong, and even when you're right, it's incredible. And I've also found that... I think I just lost my train of thought.
Also.
I did.
then tangent into, what are some of your, your favorite episodes?
Favorite episodes, definitely the one that had a musical intro. I don't even remember if it was the episode where they all go see Andy do Sweeney Todd, but they did do like a musical intro, and that resonated with me, and I loved it.
Nice.
I also like the episode where Jim and Michael, and I already forget her name, but it's the girl from Parks and Rec.
Karen?
I forget. Karen, yeah. They're all interviewing for the same job, and that's also the episode where Jan finds out she's getting fired, and it's the episode where Jim leaves Karen. I just saw that one very recently, so it just pulled at my heart, and it was fantastic.
Yeah, the ending of that episode is one of my favorite of, like, any TV moments ever, where, like, Pam's doing her confessional, and like, she's like, you know, I really hope he gets it. It's like, he's worked hard, I think he'd be a good fit. And then, like, Jim just knocks in and is like, hey, you want to grab dinner? And it just, like, cuts back to her, and she's like, sorry, what were we talking about?
And, like, and her eyes are like all red.
Yeah. Yeah. That, like, that is a build up to four seasons of them. And it's like, yes, finally, we're finally getting it. You're not drawing it out anymore. We're finally going to get Jim and Pam. Thank you.
Like, I don't even know if I have favorite episodes. I just have so many favorite bits. And even something that has to do with the show but isn't in the show.
Mm-hmm.
I've watched it so many times, but all the auditions of other people who auditioned for these beloved characters, and that panic, even when I watch it, of like what could have been or what couldn't have been. Like, Seth Rogen did an audition for that. The crazy girl from Step Brothers could have been Pam, or maybe even Jan. And just seeing, like, I almost didn't have this person be this character. And then you see, like, the actual actors auditioning, and you're like, they were the character before they were even on the show. Like, their audition is just so perfect. That was it. Like, that was the character, and it just hits me every time I watch those audition tapes of like, this really could have been a different show with just characters that it was written like perfectly, but just the wrong person could have been in that role. And that's one of my favorite things, is like, even seeing Dwight's audition, seeing that could have been, I think it might have been Seth Rogen. I'm like, that wouldn't have worked. No, I don't want that weird show.
That's, I don't think I've really ever looked at those, so I'll have to seek them out, the alternate audition videos. That's interesting.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, because then at the end of the video it shows like the actual characters auditioning, and you're like, this is perfect. Like, this, they didn't even have to tweak it for the show. Like, this is exactly who they were. Mm-hmm. And it's so great. I mean, Dwight is a character where every time you're like, this is awful. Like, this person is just the worst kind of person. But you love Dwight, and even the episode where for 2 seconds he is like the manager at the office, and he paints the whole room black, and he cries when Michael gives him the like the offer letter. I cried too, because I'm like, I hate you, Dwight, but I'm so happy for you.
Your dreams are coming true too, that's fine.
And I even love, like, everyone in the office can't stand Michael, but there's so many episodes where they all like come together for him if he's having a bad time, like when the bird died and he was really upset about the bird, even though it was about like an ex-boss that had actually died. They all thought it was stupid, and they don't want to do the stupid bird thing, but they all pull together for Michael. Even at the Dundies, they pull together, and they're just, you know, we can't stand our crazy boss, but
he's our
he
crazy
has so
boss.
Much heart, and he also, like, more often than not, he means well, and they all know that, even if they can't stand him. And that's like one of my favorite things too.
Yeah, he's never intentionally trying to be mean. And that's what Steve Carell was able to really tap into, is that he's just oblivious. There's never malice in his heart. It's just he's just stupid.
Yes, like he's never malicious. Even on the Racial Awareness Day, he says the most terrible things, and they're incredibly racist. And telling Stanley to sit in the back of the bus or drive the bus on the beach day, you're like, oh, okay. And then you're like, oh, it's just Michael. It's okay.
Yeah. One of my favorite recurring bits were all of like the gym pranks. Do you have any gym pranks on Dwight? Do you have any favorites there?
When he comes in dressed as Dwight.
That is a classic, yeah.
When that happened, I was like, bears are better than beats.
And this is all Battlestar great. Galactica.
Michael!
One of my favorites, it's a subtle one, is the, like, where he Pavlovian conditions him to, like, respond to the, like, the Windows error message or something like that, and it's like mint, and every time that comes up he's like mint, and then and then at some point like he just dings it, and Dwight's like he sticks his hand out,
he puts his hand out.
I didn't
out.
Get it in view of the camera. and Jim's like, what? and Dwight's like, I don't know.
Suddenly my mouth feels disgusting.
it's such a subtle one, and like I'm sure it went over so many people's heads to recognize what he's doing in that, but it was like it's one of my favorites, alongside the one where he puts, like, the more overt one of Jim puts like all of Dwight's stuff in the vending machine, including Dwight's wallet.
And it's like, I love when he is doing the one where he's tricking him into thinking he's a vampire.
Yeah.
Oh, this garlic bread is white hot.
So cold. No, it's like every one of those is just, and it's like it sucks because you get to a point in later seasons where they knew they'd run out of like really good ones, and so they don't ever want to like submit one that's not gonna get like the water cooler buzz and people talking about it, so they just like stopped doing them for a long time until they did come, like they would come up with like a really good one in like late 7 or 8 or something, like in the late seasons they would bring them back every now and then. That's another like montage clip video that I love. Just I'll occasionally just like Google on YouTube or something, and I'll just be like Jim Dwight pranks, and I'll just watch videos of that for, you know, a good half hour or something, just to like the Jim wrapping his entire desk in wrapping paper, and then it's just like there's nothing there. It's like,
and the stapler and the Jell-O, like that. I mean, even that's episode one.
Yeah. Like when, and then like that getting callbacks, like you were talking about earlier in later seasons and stuff. Yeah, it's there are just good moments in it. Like because it's Jim when Jim does that to Ed Helms' character, to Andy. And Andy like freaks out and has like a completely horrible reaction. It's like, oh, okay, this is who Andy is now. We now know who Andy is because we've seen this moment with Dwight, and we now know Andy is just unhinged. Cool.
I love when Andy puts his whole fist through the wall.
Yeah.
He's like, now I have to go to management training. It's anger management, but it's still management.
And really it's, I'm going to go film Hangover or something like that. But yeah, it's like, that was like, Andy is one of those characters that, like, interested me. I didn't know how he was going to fit in, and then they, like, bring him into the rest of the office, and I'm like, he doesn't fit in. And then, because he was Ed Helms and had, like, the star level, that's who they made the de facto Michael after Michael left. And I was like, this, like, they're trying to make him too much like Michael.
And I couldn't.
They've already like, undercut that by the other things they've given that character, that he does have anger and malice in him. And like pettiness that Michael didn't have, so when he does the same things that Michael would do, it just doesn't resonate the same way.
Michael is one of my favorite characters from anything because he's just like so naive, and like there's no comparing him, and you can't make another Michael, so don't try it. Just make a different character altogether. With that, when Michael left, I was like, this is fine. Like, this is my conclusion. I'm okay if the story ends here. I don't need more. Like, it ended just the way I needed it to. I cried because it was beautiful.
Yeah.
It was a perfect story.
That was another one of the Kevin moments in that BuzzFeed article. It was like, we're going to Colorado. And cuts to Kevin. All of us?
I love that show. The different weddings. The casino night was great.
Yeah, casino night's like, one of the all-time classics for me. Basically, anytime you got like Pam and Jim together before Pam and Jim were together, was like, yes, mm-hmm. yes, we're so close. Come on, keep. And then friggin' casino night ends, and Jim's like, I need to leave, and goes to the other branch for half a season. It's like, no, you brought us so close, and now they're so far away.
I know, the end of that season, you're like, oh, my dreams have come true. And then you're like, oh, they smashed all my dreams. But then they started playing Call of Duty, so I was okay for a bit.
Yeah.
So I was like, this is cool. And that's when he becomes Big Tuna, which was funny to me. Yeah. And, oh, man, I can forget stuff, and then immediately, like, you bring something up, I'm like, I have a million things more that I love about that show. Mm-hmm. I think that it was so genuine, and it was, like, unapologetic.
Yeah. I had a show that I wanted, like, I basically, when I worked, because I worked at Sam's Club and I worked at Costco for combined, like, 4 or 5 years, and I was like, I want to create an office-like show that is this, in this environment, in this retail environment. Mm-hmm. And it was basically like, it was Cart Crew, effectively, and it's like, you follow the team of cart people, but you've also got all the people inside the store, you've got the door greeters, you've got the cashiers, you've got management, and do it kind of mockumentary style, and just take all of the stories that you amass, like, working in that environment, working in retail, be it the stories that you have, like, between departments, or between a worker and a customer. Like, there is endless fodder there. And I basically even came out with, like, okay, like, here's a season's worth of ideas that I just never, like, I'm not in a position where I could ever, like, pitch that to anybody. And now there's this show called Superstore on NBC, I think, or something like that. I see, like, commercials for it every now and then. I'm like, oh, damn it, I'm pretty sure that's probably my idea that I had,
like to
7 or 8 years ago, and it's probably exactly what they're doing, and shit.
You're like, I had this idea.
Yeah. I think it's more like sitcom-y format. But yeah, it's very much like, oh, if I'd like known the right people, I could have made that neat. But it helps the idea that, like, oh, I had a good idea. Neat. That they did turn
out. Yeah, you're like, oh, that reinforced that it was a good idea.
Yeah. Like, I had, like, there was, like, the, one of the characters was basically like the door greeter who's borderline senile. And so he's basically Creed, but occasionally gives you like gems of wisdom and good advice and stuff like that.
Nice.
As the main character. But other times he's just like completely off the wall, very Creed style and stuff.
I think the mockumentary thing in The Office, without that, it wouldn't be as good of a show. Like, that is one show where it was so good with just, like, the little bits talking to the camera and stuff, mm-hmm. where the show would be so different without that.
Yeah. Oh, that's, I mean, so that's, good. And that's, like, one of the big things and why that became kind of an overwhelming format in the genre is because you can tell two stories at the same time by doing mm-hmm. that. You can have the character telling, like, with dialogue while you're showing a joke that either reinforces it or completely contradicts what they're talking about. That you can't get just showing the moment or something. So that's why you see it in like Modern Family and it continued on, you know, obviously with Parks and Rec and stuff. So it definitely, like, they recognized, I think, what they had with that and kept going. It was weird when they in the late season. Did you just completely stop watching after Michael left?
I did. I would jump in for like a random episode. Like, okay. I've seen the stuff with Will Ferrell here and there, mm-hmm. and it like tainted it for me a bit. So I was like, no, I'll just leave it where it was.
Okay.
And I just stopped it there.
So you're like nine times through. It's like you always just stop at that point.
Yeah, it's like goodbye, and Michael. I'm like goodbye, Chelsea. I'm out.
Nice, interesting. Because one of, in the last season or two. Like, they made a big deal of how, like, oh, hey, like, when's this thing actually coming out? And they, like, referred to and made made self-referential humor to the fact that it is being filmed and it is a documentary that does finally get released in, like, the finale.
That's
or
awesome.
Like that. But it, yes, it caused weird, like, things in the last season. Because Jim and Pam are having troubles in the last season or something like that, and Pam, one of the boom operators or something starts flirting with Pam and becomes a character in the show for the first time. Like, for the first time, one of the, like,
that's weird,
documentary crew people becomes a character. And it was a very, like, people got pissed off because, like, Jim and Pam don't have problems. They, like, they're the kind of couple that would communicate with another. It's not going to be Pam talking to this boom guy,
yeah,
or whatever. And so, like, people.
And Pam has never been shitty. Why would Pam get shitty all of a sudden?
It's been a while since I watched some of those late episodes and stuff, but it was like Jim was going off and trying to, like, do his own entrepreneurial thing with some people without talking to Pam about it. And so it was like, these are not these characters. Like, they would not make giant life decisions without talking to one another. And so,
yeah,
because
even when they were just friends, they talked to each other about their big life decisions. So it wouldn't make sense.
Yeah, so it's stuff like that in those last seasons that kind of rings hollow, but it was an interesting, like, they decided to bring it full circle and say, oh yeah, like, we've been shooting this thing for 10 years, and here's, you know, and like, when it airs, it's basically like the, like, snippets from, like, the pilot or something like that is kind of what they, like, and like, the whole office gets together to, like, watch it together, at Poor Richard's or something like that. It was a cute little send off, and they have some touchstones in those seasons. Like, Michael comes back for a cameo at when Dwight and Angela get married and stuff. So you get to see him, like, interacting with everybody
That's
again
cute.
For the first time after a couple years. And I don't even remember now. I don't think he comes back for the finale. I think that was, like, his finale, which was, like, a few episodes before the actual end, because he didn't want to, like, he was like, this show stopped being about me 2 years ago. I don't want to come back and make the final episode
and
about
make
me
it about me. Yeah.
So it was,
which
was
is probably what people wanted.
Yeah. Oh, I'm certainly. Yeah. But they got that with a mm-hmm. Dwight finale kind of episode-y thing.
Even just thinking of, like, when you said Jim goes off to do his own thing, when Michael went off to do his own thing out of his condo and brought Pam, mm-hmm. and on the first day he sits down in his robe wide open, you just get, like, the blurred spot in his genitalia. I think I rewatched that, like, 10 times because it was just so funny.
Yeah. Yeah. Office filled with great moments.
Excellent, like, bloopers, too. That show's bloopers are so fantastic. Of just knowing how many of your favorite bits probably took about 15 or 20 tries before finally the cast stopped laughing, mm-hmm. and just, like, let it happen before just bursting into tears. There's so many where there's, like, a slight pause where, like, okay, they got it, and then everyone just falls apart, and you're like, I would have too. Mm-hmm. Like, there's no way you can hold it together.
Yeah.
So many funny bits.
I always enjoyed the anytime they would go to the Michael Scarnwell. Like, him doing improv, where every time he's in improv, he just pulls out a gun.
Boom, boom, boom.
Boom, boom, you're dead, dead. Or like, the screenplay that he wrote, and then he basically did a find and replace for Dwight, but
he spelled
it Dwight. He spelled Dwight at one point.
So
they're like, wait, who's Dwight? And, just great cutaways to Jim basically explaining, like, we're pretty sure this is what happened.
Dwigged. I don't want to read this anymore.
Yeah.
So good.
Just such a great show. I'm trying to think, like, was, like, were Gabe and Aaron around in those seasons? Okay. Like, they came super late. Because, like, I definitely don't think I've even seen every episode, because I had fallen out of it, like, watching it kind of weekly before Michael even left. But I went through, like, I would get it on, like, DVD and stuff, and I think I have the whole mm-hmm. set on DVD, and I would watch.
The fact that it's on Netflix just makes it so easy.
Yeah, and that's what I did the other day. I popped on Netflix, and I was like, I'm going to watch a couple, like, standout episodes that I know I'm going to remember. I know I'm going to get, like, flashbacks of memories and stuff. But I definitely, like, I walked away from that instead choosing to watch like Parks and Rec for the last couple seasons of mm-hmm. The Office, checking in every now and then for like a rare episode. But like most of the stuff with James Spader, his season, I didn't pay attention to at all. And then yeah, like they did like a, I want to say in like the final season they did a bit like the Scrubs the New Class kind of thing, where it was like, okay, mm-hmm. here's like the new interns in the office or something like that, and it was like three new young and up and coming comedians. But it's like, don't try, like, don't rob the other characters of time by throwing in completely yeah. new characters that you want us to get invested in this last season. It's not, going to happen. You're wasting time that you could spend on these other characters with these new characters. I think, like, every time I see a show do that, I'm like, I hate, like, that's, you're putting, like, you can like sprinkle in new characters, like one or two kind of over the course of a season maybe, and not like mm-hmm. disrupt the flow. But when it is like, here's four new characters that have joined the cast this season and you have to start liking them immediately.
And I find that such a lazy way to do it. Like, you didn't creatively write them in, like with Andy and Karen. You're just like, temps.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's not clever.
Yeah. I very much was fine to kind of switch off in the late season of The Office. I mean, they still have like great moments occasionally, from what I've seen. But by and large, it was, I mean, like you touch on, like, there's The Office with Michael, and then there's The Office without Michael, and it does
yeah.
feel like two very different dynamics, because they didn't really know where to go with it without Michael, kind of as the leading the ship, even though it seems like they should have, because they had already come up with like so many side stories for so many characters. It was very much a like Simpsons kind of thing, where it's like, oh, okay, we yeah. like, we have such a deep pool of great talent now, we can tell a Stanley and Phyllis story, and like that can be the A line of the story and we'll be fine. Like, maybe
I do find that hard, because there was so many great side stories. But almost every side story revolved around, like, how does this affect Michael? How does Michael react to this? How does Michael affect this situation? Where you take Michael out, and it's just, it's like missing that conflict. Michael was always the conflict in everything that was going, like, even Jim and Pam's relationship, where, like, he spoils the secret right after Jim tells him, like, I'm in love with Pam. And he's like, oh, everybody, guess what? Yep. He just seems like the one who drives a lot of these stories, even though you're like, oh, this is completely about these two characters. And you're like, oh, wait, like, Michael has somehow intertwined himself into this, where without him, I don't know if the story would stand up as well. Well, for me, it definitely didn't, which is why I backed out like a wimp, but...
Yeah, it'd be interesting to now do a full run-through of the show and stick it out and see, like, how... like go through the rest of the show and see what they did with it in those final episodes, as opposed to like checking in as infrequently as I did at the end. Because yeah, there are still a ton of other great characters in that show, even without Michael. So I'm sure they have great bits and great moments.
Yeah.
That are worth exploring and seeing, even if Michael's not there. Sad face. Cool.
Very sad.
Any final Office moments? Who do you...
Everybody should watch it.
Everybody should watch it. Who do you hate in The Office? There is a correct answer.
I feel like it's supposed to be Angela, but I also love Angela because she's awful.
No, it's Toby. we all hate
you
Toby.
You can't hate Toby!
Toby is the worst.
He's nice.
Toby.
I love when Dwight asks him what the female vagina looks like. I was like, oh my god, what is this? Where is the clitoris?
Yeah, no, I mean, like, he's great, but yes, I'm saying,
supposed to hate him.
The joke, yeah. Toby is the worst. He is the, like, I mean, did you? So I mentioned it briefly. Did you also watch Parks and Rec?
I watched like the first season.
Okay.
I really liked Ron, and that was like as far as I could get with it.
Ron is certainly a standout, and I would recommend giving it a shot, especially getting past that first season, because it does that same thing, like I said earlier, where that The Office did, where it's like it gives you six episodes and they don't quite know what they're doing with these characters yet. But then you get into seasons 2, 3, and 4, and that's some of, in my opinion, some of the best, like, consistently great comedic television from a lot of the same team behind The
Office.
I'll
have to check it out.
So I think you'd get a kick out of it, and it's same kind of format. It is different, like different dynamics, different character dynamics. Part of the problem I think that they had with Amy Poehler's Leslie Knope at the beginning was that they were making her too much like Michael, and she is clueless, and
yes.
And they course correct her and make her less clueless and much more like she's just overly optimistic. In spite of government being government, and so that's where her conflict comes in those seasons. Is it's like her having an idea, knowing what's best, and then just fighting like the system, and even her employees who are like they get behind her eventually in the same way that like the team would get behind Michael. But it's very much they also a lot of times just do it like poking fun at her and at her expense. So I think it is a worthy show to follow up The Office. I think you'd enjoy it.
I will.
Certainly did. And it didn't have the same level of like huge fallout because like Amy Poehler never left the show. Now I'm forgetting his name. Guy who plays Ron Swanson never leaves the show. They have a couple people come and go over time, but
okay.
It was never like at that level. So even through the end, it like you can watch that show and it like there are episodes at the end of that show that feel as great as episodes at the beginning of that show.
Oh, that's good then.
Yeah. I think when you guys are done with this kind of run through, maybe give that one a shot.
Because David likes Parks and Rec, and I wanted him to watch The Office because I watched it twice last year, and I was like, well, I got to watch it again.
Yeah. Excellent. Yay, The Office.
Woo. Fantastic.
Fantastic indeed.